Say hi, Daddy. Say hi, Daddy.
Hi, Daddy.
Whose goddamn white baby is that?
This is your baby, okay? He's just light-skinned, too.
That one might be mine. That one right there, I'm not totally sure. Just because you name him Darren don't mean he belonged to Darren. But I don't care what this baby's name is. This baby is white-skinned, but not light-skinned. That is a white child. That is Caucasian from the mountains of Caucasus. That is a Slavic baby, a Viking from Iceland. That's a good... That baby got 730 as a credit rating right now as an infant.
You the only one I've been with, Darren.
Bitch, let me explain to you the math. I've been in here 16 consecutive years. You know how long consecutive is, don't you? Okay, so it means one right after the motherfucking other. Because I ain't never missed a day. So, clearly you've been having some conjugal visits with some other motherfuckers other than me. That's not my baby. That's almost a grown white man you brought in here. His glasses are certainly grown. I've never seen a baby with that type of prescription. And why does that baby look like Officer Joshua? Bitch, you been fucking the cop?
Hey, Darren, stop talking to my mom like that, man. Be respectful.
You're absolutely right. I apologize for that. Since this bitch, your mother was misbehaving. Sorry, should have set better example in front of the nice white gentleman and your mother. All right, so could I please speak to my black son privately, please, if that'd be okay with you, Trina? I mean, to me, no disrespect, sir. Hope to work for you one day when I get out.
Come on, babe. Raggedy head, sir.
I'm Yojairy, and welcome to the Bastien Show.
Heidi, how's it going?
Everything's going great. Thank you for having me.
Of course, of course. Let's get a little weird on the podcast for the first question. What do you think your super?
Right.
What do you think your superpower is?
A superpower.
Superpower, as an individual.
Dang, I've never been asked that question. Probably my ability to learn and absorb information.
Elaborate on that a little bit.
I got probably memorization. At this point in my life, it's probably my superpower. Nothing crazy.
Why is it your superpower?
I feel like with time and experience, a lot of repeating, I'm talking about in my personal experience with my videos, at least. I think I have that capability to just get something and learn it as soon as I can. I don't know, as soon as possible.
So what you're saying is you think you can grasp concepts very easily?
Yeah.
And regurgitate it out?
For sure. And execute accordingly. Yeah.
Okay. So let's go back to when you were in, let's say, high school, right? Say you're 15, 16 years old. What kind of kid were you? And if I was your friend, what would we be doing on a Friday night or Saturday night?
If you were my friend back in high school on a Friday or Saturday night, am I allowed to say this on camera?
What do you mean? Smoke all night.
Like, that's literally what we would do back in the day. Just get together and smoke and vibe. Listen to music. If there was a motive in town, we would try to, you know, pull up. But for the most part, I was just at the crib, you know, smoking, family, hanging out with friends. Really, like, simple shit. It's all about the simple things in life that I appreciate. So we really wouldn't be doing much but smoking and watching a movie.
Smoking and watching.
If you were my friend back in high school, yeah.
All right, so let's go younger. Elementary school. Growing up, were you a shy kid growing up?
No, I've been like this my whole life. I've been very outgoing. Usually, I was a little bit more shy just because I probably tended to get bullied a little bit more when I was younger. So it was hard for me to open up and make more friends. But yeah, I'd probably say even less. You'd see me, I would be a homebody. In middle school, I was not outside. I was not hanging out with nobody's friends. I have a very strict mother, so when I was younger, it was like, no, I'm not letting you go anywhere. So once I got to high school and I had a little bit more freedom, I was like, yes, like I could just chill, do what I do outside of my house and not be stuck in the house all the time. But in middle school, yeah, it was a lot of TV cartoons, a lot of playing The Sims. Yes, I was a simmer. I still am, but that's the only video game I was on my computer.
Okay, so you mentioned you got bullied a lot, right?
Mm-hmm.
How has that shaped you today? Like, did you learn anything from it? Did it make you close off a little bit?
No, honestly, it made me, like, understand that this is the real world and this is just the way it is. Sometimes it happens. And I know back then I was probably more insecure about my looks. That's really what. I had a unibrow back in elementary school. So that shit was tough. Like, tough. I'm not even, I'm gonna get straight to it. Yeah, like, I was butt ugly. So it was very hard to go to school at 8, 9, 10 years old. Like, I mean, so serious. I never talked about this on camera, but yeah, it was hard. But, you know, once I started going into high school, really probably like 8th grade, is when I was like opening up more and finding myself and being more myself. Because I felt a lot more pretty. I felt a lot more confident. And then high school was just like, it is what it is. I am who I am. And I started accepting myself a lot more. And I guess I would say it helped me be more like resilient and just not dwell on the past. I had a lot of resentment for the people that did bully me for a very long time. Still sometimes do, but I know how to let go of that resentment and just move on with my life. After that, I've been glowing. I feel like nothing minimum stuff. But in middle school, it was tough. I'm not gonna lie. That shit built character. That shit made me toughen up. I was like, all right, enough with the crying, enough with the sad stuff. It is what it is. And after that, I was just, didn't have to deal with that no more. But it was tough growing up. It was tough.
I mean, they say everything happens like for you, not to you, right?
Yeah.
You wouldn't be the person you are today if it wasn't for those circumstances and for the bullying.
I agree.
You look back at those moments. You think back at those moments.
It really humbles you.
It humbles you, right?
Yeah, I was like, yeah, don't get crazy. Like, even in high school, I was like, I'm not all that yet, so don't get too cocky. But I started feeling myself more, you know, getting more confident. Once I got into college is when I really felt like blossomed when it came to confidence. So it was all a journey, but yeah. If it wasn't for that, I probably wouldn't be so open the way I am now. I'd probably still be a little bit more closed off, a little more shy, probably a little bit more in the house more. But thank goodness I got over that phase of my life.
Okay, so let's talk about college. How was that experience for you?
And what college did you go to? That shit fucking sucked. I hated college. I've been wanting to talk about this shit forever. I went to UMass Dartmouth. I fucking hated
college. You hated UMass Dartmouth?
It wasn't more, actually, yeah, I did. Yeah, I'm gonna be straight up. I did not like my college experience.
Really?
I'm glad it's over, so glad. I wish I didn't go, but I did it, and it's over now. And you know what? Everything happens for a reason. Like, I have it tatted on me. I believe that to the fullest, but I'm just glad that I'm done with that chapter in my life. It was just a lot going on.
Talk about it, though. You don't have to get too elaborate, but what about your college experience was so bad?
Probably, being away from home really hit me at first. After the first year I got over, I was like, yeah, I can fuck with this. I can just be here, do school, get my job done, and get out and start working in the real world or whatever. But the whole time I knew this is not what I wanted to do with my life. Like, the whole time I knew going in that this was plan B. All right. Plan A was to become an actress, okay? And I'm working on it now. So it really shaped what I really wanted to do for the rest of my life. And I was just like, I'm over this. It was homework and working full-time or part-time even. It was just a lot. And then in the winter, the winters back down there are bad. The winters are terrible. So seasonal depression will kick in and it will stay until April, until you move back home. So it was like very sad. Like, the environment was just so cold. It's so close to the ocean, so it's always cold and windy, raining. Like, anything you can think of like depressing is UMD. I'm so sorry, because I know a lot of people in this area probably went there and they loved their experience, but for me personally, it was just not it. And I'm so happy that I closed that chapter in my life. It was cool though. It allowed me to get into stuff that I was into. Like, I did step in college. That was really, really fun. But then work started taking over my life, and then school started taking over my life. So I started feeling like I can't even do the things I really enjoy anymore because I got to do shit that I got to do and get done. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, I was just over it. I was over the party scene.
All right, so let me ask you this.
I was over everything. It was terrible. Like, that I don't even, it's so much to go into right now. But my experience was, I'm just glad that I pushed through and didn't drop out freshman year.
Okay, so let me ask you this. Yeah. What did you learn from it, though, right? You said you hated it, right? But you had to reflect. To know you hate something, you have to reflect on it.
Oh, yeah. I've done a lot of reflecting. Don't feel pressured to do something you don't want to do. Because I feel like I wasn't pressured, but I was doing it more so in the back of my head that I was doing this for my parents. I was doing this for the fact that, you know, I wanted to make them proud of me doing something like going to college, getting my degree, getting a bachelor's degree, going to work and doing something with that degree and having a nice career. But I was like, I'm not really happy. So in the end, I feel like it was 4 years wasted for me because I think of time like, dang, if I didn't go to college, imagine where I would have been right now, 23 years old, doing what I'm doing now. Like if I would have started back then, where I would have been now. Mm-hmm. So now I'm kind of a little pushed back in accomplishing the things I really want to do, which is acting, painting. I love the arts. I love entertaining. So I wanted to dedicate more time to that. And I feel like college just snatched that opportunity away from me. But, you know, it's nice to say that I do have a college degree and I'm not uneducated. It's just the experience was like, I wish I would have gone to community college if that was the case. Because it's like, oh, now I got to pay those student loans back, man. That shit is real. At first, you might have thought like, nah, yeah, sign up. Let me do this $20,000 loan for 4 years. That's 80 bands, blah, blah, blah. And you go to college thinking like, okay, when you're done college, you're going to pay that shit back. You're like, fuck, why did I do that? Like, I didn't really think it through. So I was like, never do that again. Like, never do something to please another person. Like my parents. I love them, but mm-hmm. I had to think about myself back then and say, do I really want to go to college? Is this for me? And I still went knowing it wasn't for me, but you reflect and you grow from that. But exactly. It's over with now. I'm at a point in my life where I'm a little bit more like, I could breathe. I'm comfortable. I have a job. Like I have a pet. I have everything I need right now. And now is the time to focus on pursuing more of my dreams. And then, amen. You know? Whatever comes will come. But yeah, college, I'm still looking at it like I'm grateful for the experience, but I'm glad that chapter has ended. Yeah.
Okay. What does the word fear mean to you, right? When I think of fear, the first thing that comes to my mind is false evidence appearing real. What are your fears and like what are you doing to overcome it?
Oh, not think about it. But my fear, I don't fear much except mice and death. That's it. That's about it. Everything else I can handle. If I see a mice, I'm tweaking. Like, I don't like mice. So I try to overcome that by not dealing with it. Don't think about it too much. Same thing with death. Like, sometimes I do think about death. And then sometimes when people, you know, around you pass away, you start thinking more like, dang, eventually your time is going to come too. But you just got to accept it. And that's kind of my way of overcoming it. Like, just accept that it's going to happen and it's going to be okay and not get anxious about what's going to come. But yeah, I try not to think about it. I try to deflect from it and yeah.
Say you want to take on a new task. Say there's a new opportunity that you're applying for or that you're going for, right? As a human being, like fear might just creep in because you're human. Oh, you know what I'm saying? Like mm-hmm. it's natural. So like in moments like those, what are you thinking about and what are you doing to get over said hump?
Just knowing in the back of my head that everything does happen for a reason. So if this doesn't work out, it just wasn't meant for you. Mm-hmm. And that's how I like to go through things. Like sometimes I'll get really, really nervous to go into a job interview. And I'm like, dang, I really want this job. I've had a lot of times like that where I really wanted a job, didn't get it. But in the interview process, I didn't let that fear of not getting that job get to me. I would just take the interview where it goes, go with the flow, and if it's meant to be, it will come back to me. And luckily for specific opportunities like that or even brand deals, like when the NFL reached out to me, I was just like, man, I'm nervous. What if I don't do a good job? I always look at it like, girl, if it's not going to go down, if it's not going to be good, it wasn't meant for you, and you just move on and learn from it and grow from it, but try not to think about it too much in the moment. And usually it always works. I'm like, oh, okay. Like, I'll get the job or I'll do the video and they loved it or something. Mm-hmm. And it's like, okay, you see, there's nothing really to be so scared about. And just
got to go for it.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Put yourself in the position and just do it.
Mm-hmm. And I feel like you learn the most from trying, right?
Mm-hmm. Because you don't know what you don't know. Like, in my experience, if I never posted a video, I wouldn't be where I am today.
1,000%.
If I wouldn't have posted one video, my life wouldn't be where it is now. Mm-hmm. Like, I always think about it, like, what if I didn't post that video? What if I didn't blow up? Where would I be a year from now? Completely different than where I am right now.
The hardest thing to live with is regret, right? When you talk to older people, people that are in nursing homes and things of that nature, you ask them, what is the hardest thing for you to live with in this current moment? And they say, the things that I've never done, or the things that I didn't do. That's what people think about in times and moments when they're on their deathbed, when they're about to pass away, or the things they didn't say to people, right? The I love yous they didn't say, the ego that got in the way of things.
Time is precious.
1,000%. I feel like you learned the most from your failures. What was the greatest failure? What was the failure that you learned? This is my favorite question on the podcast, actually. This is the question I asked.
You've been asking me questions nobody's ever asked me before. So it's like, dang, you putting me on the spot right now. I gotta think about it. But
so what was the greatest thing, the greatest failure in the sense of where you failed so hard and you learned so much that it changed the person you are today?
Dang. I don't, ooh.
You got it, you know.
Failed so hard.
But learn so much, right?
But so learn so much.
Remember, failure happens for you, not to you.
Yeah. Probably in college, when I was going through a really rough time, it was like my junior year, senior year, and I was just about to cross the finish line and finish, I had a moment where I stopped and realized, you're not gonna pass. Like, you're not gonna pass. It was to that point where you're like, dang, like, this is it. I went through 4 years of college to not pass. Like, that's, that really hit me. And I was like, no, there's no way. So I reflected on it very quickly and worked accordingly. And I was just hustling. I was like, no, I have to pass. And I had to push myself through reaching out to professors and explaining my current situation and just hoping for the best, getting all my work done, and doing everything in my power to not fail. And eventually it worked off, and I did pass. And that made me feel like, Jesus, like, I almost failed college. That was the moment where I was like, get it together. And thankfully, you know, everything worked out. I really pushed myself out. I snapped out of that hole I was in, and I was like, get everything done. You're almost there. And when I finished, it was probably the best feeling ever, because like I said, like, my college experience was pretty rough, so the whole time I was like, it's a marathon, like, you just gotta keep going until it's over. And once it was over, it was the biggest relief. Like, it was 1,000 pounds off my shoulder, and I felt like, okay, I did that. I could do a lot more other things, especially knowing that I thought I wasn't gonna be able to do that. I thought from the moment I got to college, I was like, I'm gonna drop out, it's not gonna work out for me. But I pushed through and I finished.
So is there an instance where, like, you failed in something currently and, well, failed in something and you're currently using that in what you do today? Because I understand with school, right? Mm-hmm. Right? You go through all that anxiety because, you know, you spent 4 years there. You spent a lot of money and you want your degree. You're paying for something and you want to complete it if you're paying for it. But is there anything that you failed in to the point where, like, okay, I failed in this specific thing, and what I learned from this thing right here is what I'm applying to what I'm doing currently?
No, you know, I haven't really done much. As I'm like trying to think, like, what have I done other than maybe creating content? But at first, when I was creating my content, even stuff like painting and stuff, I was like, dang, this isn't for me. It's not working out. Stop selling my portraits after a while. And I was like, okay, you need to focus on, what do you want to do? Do you want to make money or do you want to be happy? And I thought in that moment, I want to make money. But I realized making this type of art is what makes me happy. And I want to pursue something like the arts or entertainment, because I've always been into stuff like that. So I was like, okay, maybe painting isn't for you. Maybe try content creation. And then from there, I was like, okay, what type of content do you want to do? I always knew I wanted to be an actress. Start doing monologues, get in front of a camera, do a fake audition, read scripts. And then I started really doing it. And I was like, okay, take acting classes. What are you doing to become an actress? What steps are you doing to really do what you want to do to be happy? And I realized I wasn't doing much. So I was like, okay, I need to get into it. Mm-hmm. Once I started doing all of that, everything just started blowing up and happening all at once. So I was like, okay, you need to hone it down and realize, okay, this can work now. Start focusing and really push yourself to do this full time and focus on what you really want to do to make yourself happy right now.
Okay. You mentioned you got bullied in the past, so you had a rough upbringing. So that bullying made you second guess the way you looked, made you a little insecure. Take us back to the first time where you took your first video, the anxiety you felt.
Yeah.
Were you very comfortable taking the video, or did those little remnants of the bullying creep up on you?
Oh yeah, for sure. Cause I was like, it's the internet. The internet is ruthless. Like, they're brutal. You don't know how people are gonna react to things. They could be like, bro, you're fucking whack. You're corny. Stop doing this shit. And at that point, I was like, same with the interviews and same with any other way I approach things. What do you really have to lose? If it doesn't work out, it wasn't for you, but at least you tried. So I was like, okay, we post a video. Didn't think anything of it at all. Like, I was just being myself, being bored. And I seen a little trend going on. I was like, bet, I'm gonna do it. That'll actually help me with my scripts, with learning character development, all of that stuff that I was already in the process of learning. And I was like, put it into something, and it blew up. And I was like, okay. Once that one video went like crazy, I was like, maybe I could really do something with this. So I was like, let me try another one. Same results. People kept coming back. So I was like, okay, you got this. After that, it was like, I'm gonna take this somewhere and see where it goes. And it's been a great journey since. So I'm glad I got in front of the camera and did it. Cause if not, I really don't know where I would be a year from now. Like back then when I started, it's crazy.
Your first video to blow up, it was Stephen A. Smith's, correct? Which one was it?
It was one of them. It was Kanye. It was a Kanye video. He was talking about Lady Gaga and Polaroid, and what the fuck does she know about cameras? And I was like, this shit is, I forgot about that. And I was like, yeah, let me recreate this moment and put a little of my own spin on it. And I was like, okay. Whatever happens, happens. Posted it. Didn't think nothing of it. Came back. They were like, yo, I seen your video. I'm like, what? The internet is the internet. And so somebody see your video and they mention it and you're like, oh shit, like, yeah, I did post a video last night, but okay, didn't think nothing of it. But yeah, it was a Kanye video, the first video.
Okay,
that went crazy.
So take us through your creative process. How do you go about structuring your videos, and what do you keep in mind in regards to the algorithm to make sure that it actually does go viral?
So people think there's so much to it, like, oh my god, how long do you take to do your videos? Like, what prep do you take? They're always asking me the same questions, and I always put it into a very simple, like, I try to explain it very simply. I take any videos
take
or
notes,
like
we're listening.
Take notes. I watch videos just like you guys do, any viral videos, or like videos that spark a memory in your head. They're like, oh, I remember that. I want to recreate it. Like, I always go back to White Chicks. That's one of my favorite movies. And I'm like, dang, I want to recreate something like that. Like, or I want to be inspired by that and do something with it. So I'll take a video, be like, okay, I like that. I want to do it. I want to show it to the people. I want to put it on my platform so other people can see and know about it. I will write down everything. That's the best way to learn and memorize things, is writing down for me. So I'll write down everything they're saying. If they sigh, I'll put they sigh. Like, I literally write a script. Like, if this is a movie,
okay, so
it's a serious business.
So you analyze a video.
Everything,
it's,
yes.
It's like you're doing homework.
Yeah, just writing down, going over a lot of repetition, watch it a couple
do
times,
you time
get
stamp?
It. I do timestamp.
So do you say, like, at 1:33 they sigh, and you go.
Yeah, literally, I to the T, I'll just put it down. If I'm going in between scenes, or if I'm doing multiple people, I'll timestamp that. Go back, do a scene here, do another scene here, do another scene here. It's literally like a whole movie set in my room on my vanity with my camera. Like, it's so fun. I don't even know how to explain it. You really gotta see it to know what I mean. But I'll just get on my bed, watch the video, write down everything. Then watch the video a couple times through. Really understand what they're saying. I really feel like every person I do is a character. In real life, like, I'm just playing a role. So analyze everything, get it down packed. Then I start talking out loud to try to see if I can speak like them, if I can get an accent in even better, do whatever I gotta do to embody that person. And then I'll be like, okay, I'm ready to go. Everything's memorized. Record. Do it a couple times. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, take one. Oh, damn, that didn't work. Take two. Okay. Take three. All right. Give myself a limit. Be like, no, you gotta do it within three takes and the rest is history, because you're gonna go crazy. But after like 3 or 4 or 5 takes, really look at every take I do, keep them in my drafts for memories and like to refer back to, because people are like, we want to see bloopers. So I try to keep those. And then I just pick whichever one I did best in, mm-hmm. personally, what I like the best. And I'm like, I'll look at my videos and be like, that's funny. And I'll just be like, yeah, this is the one.
You told us that you have your own process, right? Mm-hmm. You do the takes, you pick which one is the best for you. What are the little technical details that you look into, right, in regards to posting the video or making the video? And what I mean by that is, do you use videos off of your camera roll? Do you record it straight from TikTok? Mm-hmm. Or do you, like, those little minute things?
Everything to end up with the final product is basically what you're, like, what the, yeah. Okay, so I,
well, basically,
yeah, a lot of people put captions and stuff. I don't mm-hmm. do a lot of that. Before posting, I do take specific hashtags because that does work with the algorithm on TikTok on my end. So I'll really just tag anything that's relevant to the video. Whether I'm making a Stephen A. Smith video, I'll put the NBA, ESPN. Anything that has millions and millions of views on it, it'll be seen a little bit more quicker, I feel like.
So let's get specific. How many hashtags?
It all depends on the video, mm-hmm. but I'll go crazy. Like, I'll do like 6 to 8.
Wow.
Hashtags, and it'll go recommended on people who want to look for stuff like basketball, NBA. You put those hashtags, people who are into basketball and NBA, they're going to see those videos. People mm. who are into everything, they're going to see those type of videos because that's what they've been liking recently, and it'll all just... So I guess, like, people who see my videos, they be watching videos of, like, Flavor of Love, and they'll watch videos of, like, ESPN, and I'm like, okay, I guess this works. And that's all I really do. Nothing too crazy. Sometimes I'll tag the people if they have a TikTok account so that maybe one day they could see my work. And they have, so it works. That's when I'm like, just tag them, give them their credit. I'll put where it's from, like if it's a specific episode from a show or something. I'll get really, really specific with what I'm recording for the general population to understand what I'm doing. So it works for me every time. I'll usually do a sound in the background. I don't do my own sound. Like, I'll put a song or a specific like theme song or something in the background, but you'll still hear my voice. Little things like that. Like, people, like those sounds that you see go viral on TikTok, I'll put those sounds in my video, mute it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that way you can get it seen a little bit more, and it works. Mm. It works. That and being consistent, because if you stop being consistent on platforms like TikTok, it really shows in your followers, your view count. Because I took a break for a while, and I could tell, like, do-do-do-do-do. So I'm like, oh, okay, if I want to keep this momentum going, you got to stay consistent and drop, like, have a schedule. Do 3-4 videos a week. Do this a week. Like, do this next week. Do stuff that's relevant right now. Like, when that whole Will Smith thing was going on with him and Chris Rock, I did a video that same night. I was like, nah, mm-hmm. we're bringing this out right now while it's still relevant. Stuff like that you keep in mind, and usually it'll pop up like everywhere on TikTok. At least I don't know, that algorithm is crazy, because I'll be trying on YouTube and it's not the same wave. YouTube is hard to come up on, so I give you props over here, almost coming with 1,000 followers, I mean subscribers on YouTube. Like, that shit is crazy. Almost, but almost. I'm at like 200, and that's with my 800,000 followers on TikTok. I'm still at like 200 on YouTube, so it's like, dang, that shit is hard. But I give people props, because shit ain't easy. Like, maybe TikTok, because I do see a lot of people coming up on TikTok now, and it's easier mm-hmm. to get spread out like that. But stuff like what you doing is hard, so I give you your props, man. Congratulations. I give
you your props.
I hope everything is stay successful on this end, because I'm like, dang, YouTube looking slow for me. I don't know.
I give you. You're about to close a million followers. What do you mean?
Soon, hopefully, yes.
How has your life changed? Let's talk a little bit about how your life changed, but let's also talk about the people reaching out to you, right? Yeah. Brand deals, the collaborations.
Yeah. So I was like very overwhelmed in the beginning, because it happened so fast. And it just kept happening. So it's like, okay, this is staying consistent for now. Keep doing it. I was like, okay, once the people that I started recreating started reaching out, that's when I knew. I was like, okay, this is getting real. Like, how did you see my video, dude? It was just this little girl from Lawrence. Like, how did I come up in your vicinity? But it's crazy. When they reach out, I'm just like starstruck from the internet perspective, because I know if I met them in real life, it's going to be real chill. But it's like, whoa, you really saw my content is crazy to me. I think the moment I knew shit was real was when Drake commented on one of my videos. And then it got really real when he posted it on his story. I was like, nah, how you come across me twice?
Look at this. Don't talk to me. Talk to these people. It's about these people right here. It's about these people. It's about the city. Listen. We have the best player. We have the best fans in the whole NBA, in the whole world. Look around. Look around you. Look at this. We created this. This didn't exist before we were here. Look around at the square. I promise you right now. We did this. Doesn't matter what anybody says. They can say it's disrespectful. They can say it's this and then that. Everybody's within the rules. Everybody's doing their thing. All we are is proud and passionate. We are like a college sports team. The Toronto Raptors are a college sports team. I promise you. I love Toronto. I love this team. And we're going to the NBA Finals. Let's go!
In this life, like, it's crazy. That's when I was like, yeah, this is over. Like, what? And then the people started hitting me up for collaborations. I'm like, I love this. And more people wanted to talk to me and reach out to interview. I was like, dang, like, this internet stuff ain't the internet no more. It's like real life. Like, you got people. Actually, one day, it was like last week, I was at Market Basket just getting groceries. Some white lady came up to me. She was like, I love your videos. Like, she ran up to me. I was at the register. I was like, what? Like, I thought she was going to be like, hey, what are you doing? Or like, yell at me. She was like, I love your videos. Just like that, looking at me dead in my eyes. She's like, I recognized you from the soda aisle. Didn't want to say anything, but I saw you again. And I was like, let me just do it. I love your videos so much. She came and gave me a hug. She was mad nice. I was like, oh, shit, you got me scared. Like, damn, I don't get recognized in real life. So it's like, this TikTok internet shit is real. I don't know, but it was so nice. I was like, dang, I appreciate you. Like, when people reach out to me, like, yo, you're doing your thing. I appreciate it. I always reach out back. Like, thank you so much for the support, because I wouldn't be here without people actually watching and spreading the word and, like, being like, yo, you wouldn't have interviewed me if it wasn't for somebody like, yo, do her or something, you know what I mean? So it's I really appreciate everybody who likes the content that they see and want to see more, because that only motivates me more to keep going and know that I'm doing something right. But yeah, it's been crazy. I have brand deals, people reaching back, people following back. So I'm like, whoa. But, you know, I try not to overthink it, because I'm like, yo, I still live here in Lawrence. I'm still a city girl. I'm still haven't done nothing crazy, but I know, like, this is a step forward to, yo, I could really do this and really do something big with this. So it's been great. It's been mad motivating, not gonna lie. I had no motivation before for anything. So I was like, let me do a video. Mm-hmm. After that, I've had all the motivation in the world. It's crazy.
Okay, so this is a question that a lot of people are wondering. I'm wondering. Limby behind the camera is wondering. Everybody's wondering.
Are you really? Okay.
He is, trust me. How much money do TikTokers make? And I don't want you to get into your pockets like crazy. I don't want you to tell people how much you make a year or salary or whatever.
That's fine.
How much do TikTokers really make, right? Like, when you guys get those gifts, when you guys go live, when people just want to donate just to donate, how much are you guys really making?
I know for sure the content creators that do it full time and that's like their job, they get paid pretty good money. Cause it's not just from TikTok, it'll come from TikTok and it'll transfer on to any other platform you have. We'll work with you on Instagram if you have a following on Instagram. We'll work you on Twitter. We'll do this. We'll give you this. You can come to Fashion Week. It's real. Like, TikTok now is blowing everybody's careers up. So I know that the influencers that get all the views and all the followers, they're getting paid good money. But me, somebody like lower, like on the lower tier of like top TikTokers, the pay is decent. Definitely can't survive off of it. But, you know, it's nice, like passive income for sure. Brand deals have been the best part of it all. Those checks are nice. Nice. Because when it comes to brand deals and partnerships like that, you know your worth and you tell them your worth before they even want to work with you. They know ahead of time, yo, my rate is $5,000, before asking you, can you do this for us? So it's like knowing your worth and having that confidence to be like, this is me, this is, will you want me to do this for you? This is the price. Yesterday's price is not today's price. So It's nice to know, like, yo, you really are in control when it comes to this content creation stuff. You have the value. You bring it to the table. They will pay you your worth. And it's been gone. The money's coming. It's nice, like, leisure money. Like I said, it's nothing crazy. But it's definitely, like, wow, I never imagined I would get paid to do videos and stuff like that. It's cool. It's dope.
So let's go into the brand deals a little bit. What kind of brand deals do you have? Like, what do they ask you to do? Are they asking you to just...
do my thing, yeah.
They're just asking you to do your thing.
Do my thing, yeah.
They're not telling you to say anything specific. They just said, do your thing and what, like, hold a can of soda while you're doing it?
Nah, I don't get... Well, I have only gotten two major opportunities in my eyes, which was one, the NFL, and two, I got an opportunity with Hulu. So those right now, those are the only ones I've accepted because all the other offers, I feel like, are not worth what they're asking. Because I be seeing now, I'm like, yo, all these influencers doing all these brand deals, they be asking for the most, and they don't pay you your worth. Like, they're offering you free merchandise, but money talks. Like, don't nobody want a free t-shirt, bro. I'm sorry. Like, I'm over that phase of my... I will not do the deal if the money's not on the table. Like, but it is what it is. And that's why I'm like, at least you know your worth. Don't accept offers that you don't think, okay, I'm doing mad work for something that's not paying me off as much, or something that I know I could do better on my own and get more money on my own. So that's what I had to learn when it came to, like, negotiating and stuff like that. But with those two deals, it was literally like, we just want you to do your thing and we'll post it on our end. You post it, you promote, you know, a little bit of this, and that's it. Like, you just let us know the metrics, let us know the stats of the video, and that's about it. They don't ask for too much. Like, I always think about partnering up with companies that I actually value. Like, I won't do any brand deals or partnerships with companies that I'm like, I don't use this fucking water bottle. I don't want to do your freaking ad. I don't know. Like, I'm not doing it. And it got to make sense for what I do. Because how am I doing the videos I do where I'm, like, acting and stuff and I'm advertising, like, perfume and makeup? Like, it don't make sense to my brand or what I'm trying to promote. So I know that the deals I do take, it makes sense in my end. Like, the NFL, I love football. I was like, hell yeah, I'll do one of the videos for you guys. They were like, we want you to do one of these. Give us an option. You pick. I said, I want to do this one, actually. Did it. Boom. That was done with Hulu. Same thing. They gave me the opportunity to do, I could talk about it now because it's live, but I did a partnership with Hulu where I did one of my little videos for their Lakers documentary. And I love documentaries. One thing about me, I love documentaries. So it made sense for me right there. And I was like, yo, these are the type of collaborations that I am willing to do, even if the pay is not that good, just because I believe in what I'm doing. Like, I actually am happy and satisfied with the end product. So with those two deals, it was great. They just really told me, do your thing, and we'll give you some feedback. If it looks good, you're good to post it, we'll get you paid. And I'm like, yo, this is awesome. Like, content creation is cool.
Let's talk about the NFL a little bit. I want you to elaborate on that. When you first got the email, how'd you feel?
I was like, this is a scam.
Did you think it was fake? I was going to ask you.
Yeah, I was like, fake? This is a scam. Like, and then I was like, okay, what are you going to lose? Like, and I sent their little email tags is like really the NFL. So I'm like, okay, let me just open up and be like, okay, what do you guys want from me? And they were like, yeah, we want you to be a part of this. And they were already promoting it. So I was like, okay, I know it's a real, like, event that they're hosting. So if they're asking me to do it, give them an opportunity. I did two videos for them. One was just doing my thing. Another one was for Super Bowl weekend. They were going to throw my video live on. It was like a TikTok tailgate. So it was just like a TikTok live. And they were just posting, like, content from creators that did it specifically for the Super Bowl. And we just executed it and sent them the videos. And they were like, yeah, we want you to do another one. I was like, oh, say less. I was like, what? After the first one, I was like, here you go. And they were like, no, we want you to do another one. I was like, bet. Like, of course, if you want more, let me know. And yeah, I hope to hopefully make more content for them in the future. But those two videos that I did for them was really, really cool. I appreciated the opportunity. And I was like, wow, this is like real life. And then when I got the check, I was like, all right, this shit is real. I'm sorry, this ain't no scam. No, I was still a little... I was a little skeptical. I was like, I don't know. And then the check came in clear. And I was like, oh, shit, I really did that shit for the NFL. Okay. It was humbling. I was like, oh, all right.
And the exposure.
It was so cool.
Was on a different, is on a different level, right? The NFL, they've been around for so long.
So I'm like, this is crazy. And I love football. Like, if it's between football and basketball, I'm a football girl. So I was like, stop. The NFL you get to me is crazy.
That was a punch right there. You're picking football over basketball.
I am so sorry. I will write down for the NFL.
You're crazy.
Yeah, I'm not. I was over basketball season. It's football season now, so you're gonna hear about my excitement. Right? Y'all had your little finals. Y'all had everything. It's our turn now, but okay. I was so happy to do it for them. I was like, hey, this is lit. Like, it's been a great journey.
It's so exciting to see somebody from Lawrence, from my hometown.
Like, I know.
Doing big things. No. I love it. And I know, like, everybody supports it. When I seen it, it was out of the blue. I reposted it right away. I was like, she's from Lawrence, boom.
That's right.
It. That's how people look at it. Like, oh, you're from my city, boom. That little push, you don't know who might see it.
Exactly. I'm like, this shit is crazy. It's overwhelming. But then I'm like, I still have so much work to do. Trust me, I'm working behind the scenes. But I'm grateful for the journey so far. If this is where I am now, it's only going to go from here. That's the way I see it and try to think about it. And I'm just keeping it pushing, doing everything I got to do to make this dream a possibility. You're going to see me at the Oscars one day. Like, I'm being
so
serious.
You gotta manifest it.
Of course.
Yeah,
I already manifested
my life. Say it with more confidence, though. Take your hair out of your head.
Oh, you will
say
see
confidence.
Me. Hold on.
You got that.
You will see me at the Oscars in less than 5 years. I'll put that on my life. Maybe not the Oscars, but definitely the Emmys, because I'm more into TV right now. But you're going to see me in a movie or on a TV show real soon. Like, I'm working. I'm really working. Like, this is motivating me a lot. I'm like, oh, shit. This plan B with college, nigga, you know? Start looking at it like, this is plan A now. It's plan A is working, so keep working towards plan A. Forget the plan B, and that's what I've been doing, and staying consistent.
And that's the right mindset to have, because when people amass that amount of fame or that amount of notoriety, they start to get cocky, right? Gets to the head, and then once you get complacent, that's when you actually lose.
Exactly.
Complacency is the death to all dreams.
Oh, yeah. I still keep it cool. Like, I still look at it like, no, you still probably got like 1,000 followers. You don't got 800,000. I don't look at it at the numbers. I don't look at nothing. I'm just like, man, whoever likes the content will come. And they've been coming, so I'm like grateful for that. But I don't let that get to me like, oh, my God, I have so many followers. Like, yeah, but you don't know who I am? Like, no, you don't know who I am. I'm still working, like, behind the scenes. So I got to stay true to myself still. Ain't nothing changing right now. I'm just working towards something bigger and better. But
something awesome. I also say is that, like, the internet is fake. People got to realize that as
well.
That's
what I'm saying. It ain't real life until it happens in real life for me. But before this, I've been like, oh, no. This, even still to now, you're like, you're a million followers.
But even though, right, you have your million followers, but you're putting on your persona, right? You're putting on the act. You're an actor to an extent. Right? A lot of individuals, they take things like the social media so serious. They think it's actually real life.
And that should be their biggest downfall. I'm like,
that is the biggest downfall.
It's crazy. But no.
So what would you tell younger Yojairy, right? Yojairy, who was that young, insecure, shy kid. Like what would your current self tell your former self in regards to advice?
Stay true to what you really like, and don't be ashamed of what you like, for sure. That, and also don't make a decision you know you're gonna end up regretting, because it does stink. But just know everything is gonna be great. You don't even know what's coming. You got a lot of potential, young one. That's what I was telling him. Like, You got something. Don't think you don't got something. You got something in there. And just keep it pushing. Like, I would have been like, yeah, all right. I'm never going to become famous. I'm never going to be an actress. I'm just going to be a lowly accountant. No, you're not. You're going to be something someday. Don't worry. Just keep pushing.
The thing I love about your story so much is the fact that you were doing this as a hobby.
Yeah.
Right?
I still am. I don't rely on TikTok. Mm-hmm. It's not my main form of income. It's literally a hobby. I feel like everybody needs three hobbies. A hobby to get you in shape, a hobby to stimulate your creativity, and a hobby to make you money. This happens to now be a hobby that makes me money, but it was a hobby for real to, like, just let loose and have fun with my creativity and see where it goes from there. So I'm glad that now it's become a hobby that I could, like, actually, like, dang, I can make money, invest in myself more. All the money I've made on TikTok has gone back to me to better myself, back to acting classes, headshots, anything I gotta do to further my career in acting, all my money from TikTok has been going to that. So it's like being reinvested, focus on myself and just take it day by day, but stay consistent is the biggest thing I would have said to myself.
So let's talk about the haters, right? With you amassing about a million followers, there must have been somebody or people around you to an extent. The energy must have shifted to an extent. Tell us about it a little bit.
I would say if anything, the energy shifted to more people like reaching out and being like, yo, that's what's up. Like people that I've seen around and like they probably never noticed me, but they've like reached out like, oh shit, you're doing your thing. I'll see more of that, at least around in this area, but.
Really?
Yeah, like.
Nobody around you got envious that were like, yo, like that possibly stopped you from doing it?
Oh, no, no. Not in front of me, at least. Probably thinking about it. That's on them. But to me, no, it's been nothing but support and love. I've been mad grateful, you know? But I know it's out there. I know it's there, rare. lingering around somewhere. Lingering in my comments, I bet. But I don't even think about the hate like that. I don't know. I just do my thing. Luckily, I mean, I don't want no problems with nobody. I just be doing my own little videos. That's all. I don't want no
it's
beef.
It's very rare. Okay.
Yeah, I don't want no beef.
So how about your parents? What do they think about it?
I think it's interesting.
When you started, did you tell them, ma, I want to be boom, boom, boom. I want to be an actress. I'm going to be doing TikToks. Did you explain that to them prior? Or did you just go into it? And then when things started blowing up for you, did you just show them?
They knew. Like, I told them, I'm telling you, I've been wanting to be an actress for years. And I was always saying, like, I'm going to be an actress one day. I'm going to be an actress one day. Don't forget it. And then we look at it like, yeah, you still need to go to college, though. And then after college, I was like, I'm going to be an actress. Like, I'm still going to be an actress one day. So, I don't know. You're going to start dealing with these, with this hecticness going on in my bedroom. She'd be wondering, like, what is she doing in there? At first, I didn't tell her about none of that stuff. Like, probably after, like, the 10th video, I was like, yo, I'm doing this for real. Like, what I tell you, I'm recording, mom. This is serious now. Like, I'm a big deal now. You understand? No, but I would be like, yeah, she would respect it. She'll give me my space while I record if I'm doing something. Cause I still live with my mom's. We cool and everything. But she'll help me record it. She's like, oh, sorry. Like, she'll know what's up now. My pops, he was like, I see you doing TikTok, but like, what's up with that? And I'm like, yeah, it's cool stuff. He don't really mind it either. I don't think they understand like what it really is, but they be seeing it. They're like, I see people post your videos, but I don't see you posting your videos or anything like that. I'm like, yeah, I'm kind of a big deal on the internet or whatever. And they're like, oh, cool. Oh, you still here though? And I'm like, yeah, don't worry. It's a work in progress. That's why I'm like, you right. I appreciate them for that. They humble me down. They're like, yeah, all right, keep doing your little videos. And I'm like, yeah, don't worry. One day when you see me on the TV, you're gonna be like, oh shit, you on TV and didn't tell me? Like, I've been telling you I'm working, you know what I'm saying? But they've been cool about it. They've been really supportive, of course. I'm grateful that they give me that space to be comfortable in my house to like just do random videos and just scream at the camera sometimes. And it's fun. Like, they be going for it. They're like, yeah. They be watching my videos, sending my videos. I'm like, oh my goodness. But I'm like, thanks for the support. But I'm like, oh God. They be like, look, it's you. I'm like, yeah.
So let me ask you this. Do you think you can post anything and it will go viral? Or would it have to be those specific types of video? Example would be like, say tomorrow you want to do something completely different. Mm-hmm. There's a whole nother trend out there.
Yeah.
And you post it. Do you think your followers will gravitate towards you on that new trend? Or do you think it has to be within the niche that you're in?
No, I think they're still pretty supportive. I think they like my vibe as a person just because I've done other things on TikTok. Like, I've done a whole Omegle series where I go on Omegle and just talk to random people. Like, no crazy shit. I won't post nothing crazy. It's literally me getting to know random people on Omegle. I'll post little snippets. I'll ask them for their permission. Like, yo, I'm gonna post this on my TikTok. This little interaction. Is that okay? They'll be like, yeah, it's cool. And they'll be like, I saw your video. I'm like, yeah, I told you I was gonna post it on TikTok just so you wouldn't be thrown off. But I'll show stuff like that. I do a lot of, like, when I go out to eat restaurants, I'm a foodie. So I always recommend good restaurants out here in the Boston area. And people like it too. Like, people from like Cali or New Jersey be like, yo, where is that? I'm like, mass, you figure it out. Come out here. But yeah, I just show my life sometimes. And they still like it. I used to make videos with like different sounds back like a couple months ago and people still liked it. I'm like, okay, So I guess they watch me because they mess with me as a person. Like, it's not specifically that trend. And I appreciate that. I'm like, yeah, you know, it's not always just about that. I'll show my own personal style and personality on my videos too, even though I recreate a lot of my videos. But yeah, I try to switch it up sometimes. I think they still do pretty good, but not as good as these videos. I feel like people really know me for that. They'll be like, yeah, we want you to do this, though. We want you to do that. You know how many people hit me up all the time? Like, yo, you gotta do this video. Like, you gotta do this one. I'm like, I know it's a lot, like, because I work full time and do content creation on the side. So it's like, I try my best now. Before I was unemployed and my TikToks were blowing up, I had a lot more free time. I could bang out like 5-6 videos a day. Now I'm lucky if I get like 3 videos a week. Like, that's pushing it, because I don't have any more time anymore. I'm just so busy. But I'm still grateful that people still come and watch, even if I take a month-long break. They're like, yo, she came back. They'll be like, it's good to see you back. Like, thanks for posting again. I'm like, yo, yeah, they waited. And I'm like, oh, okay, so it's good to know that y'all still here. Y'all still rocking with me. I appreciate all of that.
So you're busy, and you still managed to make it on the show. That's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, right? I was like, when you thinking this week? Because sometimes they'd be like, let's try for like 2 weeks from now. So I was like, maybe he'll ask me for 2 weeks. Luckily, I was chilling this week. I was like, I could do Wednesday. I could do Friday. So I was like, yeah, I'll do it. Let's bang it out. Let's do a quick interview. Get to know each other. Chop it up. And that's it, you know? I always try to make time for things that I want, at least. That's why I was like, I'll do it for you. Because I don't mind. I was like, all right, it's in Lawrence. I don't got to drive to Boston. I don't got to drive. No, I'm down the street. Mm-hmm. Cool to connect with people from my city. So I was like, yeah, but usually I'm like slammed. At work, I'm slammed. Come home, I'm trying to get more into the gym too. So it's like, I'm trying to spread out my time to do other things that I'm interested in. Like, I want to learn how to play the piano. I have a keyboard in my room. So it's like, dang, I got to make content. You got to take the time out. You got to learn the material. You got to, it's like, it takes some time sometimes. But yeah, but when I do have time, I'll be like, let me do a quick video. Like, I haven't posted a video in probably like 2 weeks. And I did one last week. It was a Cat Williams video. When I tell you that shit went viral, like, I was not expecting it to go viral. I was like, oh, wow. I got like 1 million views in like 3 hours. I was like, okay. Mm-hmm. It actually broke my personal record already for my views on my TikTok. And I was like, dang. And that's me not posting in a week or two. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, dang, people are still watching. This shit is crazy. Every time I post, I'm like, dang, y'all still watch my videos. It's crazy. After a year of doing the same shit, people are like, yeah, keep doing that shit. You, what you doing? You doing the right thing. Keep it going, bro. I'm like, all right, I'm good. I really like the support. And I'm glad people don't, like, are tired. They're like, girl, do something else. I'm like, I like what I do. I like the content I make. It's like an endless pool of content. You could always come up with new things, new characters to play.
Yeah, because everything's going viral all the time. Like, yeah, any little thing.
Any little viral thing. So I'm just grateful that people still care.
That's a good mindset to have as well, right? You always got to be appreciative of the people that are supporting you.
Yeah.
That's the only way you're going to get to the next level.
Exactly.
So what impact do you want to leave on the world? I know you're humble, but I want you to get a little cocky from you.
Mm.
And humble at the same time, to an extent.
I just like making people laugh. Yeah. I always been the type that, like, if it's a sad situation or it's not the right time, I always try to look at the positive or the bright side of things and try to make people laugh to, excuse me, feel a little better. So that's it. Like, if I could do anything in life, it's just to entertain and make people smile and make people, like, come back and see more, because it makes me happy seeing other people happy and like what I do. And I'm glad I could, like, make somebody's day better. Like, you know what it is for a stranger in, like, I don't know, the UK, reaching out to you like, yo, I actually had this one person from the UK email me, like, personally, because they were like, you're probably never going to see this, but I'm reaching out just to let you know that I really appreciate your videos and you make my day. Sometimes I've been having a really down time and I always come back to see your videos. I'm like, dang, that's probably the biggest impact I could leave on anybody, is just like, you made my day. I'm like, I did my job. I did what I wanted to do. Job's done. I hope I could keep making you laugh and smile and make you feel good and make you feel happy, because I went through a rough period in my life where I was not laughing. I was like, no, I'm just down and I don't want to ever go to that point in my life again. And after this hobby I've come into, I'm like, yo, I've never been sad since. I've been super happy knowing that what I do makes other people happy, like, for real. That shit is so, I'm blessed. I feel very blessed to be in the position I am right now, to just show what I got to offer and make people's days and make people happy.
I mean, you're chasing your passion, right? You're chasing your purpose. There's no way you're not going to be happy.
Right. That's why I'm like, it's only up from here. Like, through down times and times where it's rough, just look past it, keep pushing forward. Everything's going to go up. Like, there's no way to go down from here. So
I feel like the individuals who are the unhappiest are the individuals who are stuck, right? They feel like they're stuck at a dead-end job. They don't know what they want to do. Mm-hmm. But that comes with self-awareness and self-reflection.
Yeah.
For sure. How has self-awareness and self-reflection worked to your benefit in your journey?
I've looked back on it every day. I think back on times where I was like, this is not working for me. I'm not happy, especially last year before everything happened with my content creating. I was in a low place.
Would
like
you call
I
it depression?
Not depression, but more like you're finding your purpose. You're like, what do I want to do with my life? And it didn't hit me until last year before everything. And I knew exactly what I wanted to do. I'm like, this isn't making me happy. I was working at a bank and I was crying every day on my break, coming back to work, going home and crying because I had to go back to work the next day. And I was like, I don't ever want to feel like this in my life ever again. And I left to pursue something that I had, you know, already have faith. And I was like, you know what, let me try doing content for a while full time. And it worked to my advantage. I was so surprised, and I still feel blessed that I was making money strictly off of my content for a long time, and I was doing great. And I was like, okay, well, I'm glad that I finally have a hobby that I could just have fun, get paid off of it. And then I was like, but what's next? What's the next step? You can't be doing this forever. Like, you know, there's more to this. This is just the first step. And it just pushed me harder. And I know that in a year, if all of this could happen in 1 year of just straight work and dedication and motivation, I can only imagine what the next year is going to come with more discipline, more investing in myself, and just knowing that this was meant for me and this is the road I'm going to take and everything's going to come to me with time and with grace and just keep pushing forward. I'm like so blessed right now, though. Mappy, not- but I'm like, yo, I really feel blessed, man. This shit crazy. This is only gonna go up from here.
Now, and you're right, right? Like, when individuals get to the level you're at, they think this is it. I'm done. I made it. But when in reality, they should be thinking about
what's next.
Keep what's going. Next, or they should be using this as a gateway to the next level, right? Mm-hmm. There's a lot of NBA players, NFL players, professional athletes that they go broke after they're done playing basketball because they had no plan B. They had no guidance, second plan. They had no investments. Mm-hmm. They were just like, I play basketball and that's all I do. So it's very happy to see that you're thinking in that manner.
Yeah, and I definitely, like, not to say that I'm not grateful for my even my college degree, even if I'm not gonna use it in the long run with my acting career, I'm still grateful for this opportunity to have a degree, have a stable job where I can have the income to invest in myself and have that downtime to make content, which is one of my favorite hobbies. I'm like, I'm great that I can balance work life and content creation, and everything's going smooth right now. So it's been great. Yeah, it's smooth. And I'm telling you, it's all about consistency. You've seen it yourself. Like, how long have you been doing these interviews on YouTube? And so you're only growing from here, though, right?
To answer your question, yeah. So my last interview was in January. But,
oh, dang.
Yeah, so January. So I'm starting everything back up again because I'm the type of person where I don't want to start something and then go on a hiatus. Mm-hmm. That was my last interview for the last season. You know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
So now, like, I'm starting up. I have another interview on Sunday, then I have another one next Wednesday.
Okay.
You know what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
All big guests, all people on your caliber.
Yeah. Oh, really? Yeah. People I'm excited to see more. Like, this is exciting. I'm glad to see people in the city collaborate with each other and blow up together. Like, we gonna make it, don't worry.
we
out here, you know
the
what
thing
I'm saying?
Is that it's you can only grow with collaboration. Right, a lot of individuals think they can make it on their own, especially with the media company. Like, we got Limpy behind the camera, shout out Limpy, but we're a team.
Yes, sir.
Right, like, everything I do is for the betterment of the team.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not doing this podcast for me. Once this gets up and running, right, we're nearing 1,000 subs. Then we get to 2,000, then 5,000, 10,000. I'm going to start divvying out to the team. You get what I'm saying? Like, everybody got to eat.
As you should. Yeah.
I'm not trying to eat by myself, bro. It's lonely at the top if you don't bring anybody up with you.
Exactly. That's at what, least you know.
And that's what I'm saying.
That's what's up. Keep it going. Like, we just gotta keep the the marathon continues. Sure. Yes, sir.
The marathon for sure continues. Out of this interview, the thing that I got the most out of was your consistency. You really put in the effort. You kept going regardless of what life threw at you, mm-hmm. which is very important. And a lot of individuals think they should go viral after the first post, after the second post. But you're like, nah, let me do 10 posts. Let me do 20. Let me do 30. So that's very commendable.
Yes, yes. It's been a long year, but it went by so fast. I was actually looking back on my content. I've made 115 videos in 1 year.
That is crazy.
I have been so many characters that I don't even know where to. People are like, what's your favorite? I'm like, I don't even know anymore. I've done so many, and that's not a bad thing, but it's just like, dang, I really have done so many, and that's just all about the consistency. Like, I'm glad that I could be like, yeah, I don't know which one to pick because I've done so many. I would be so sad if I was like, had like 5 videos, didn't keep going, didn't know the potential I had. Maybe I could do more. And I'm looking back at it, I'm like, I have so much to offer now. I can show so much of my work and what I can do, what I can bring to the table. So it's good to look back at those memories and be like, dang, it's been a great year. A lot can happen in a year. Your 1 year could change your whole life, because this last year, 2021 to 2022, changed my life in a huge way. And I'm grateful for everything. I'm grateful for all the people that have reached out to me. I'm grateful for the people that still watch my videos. I'm grateful for the people that are going to watch this interview just because I'm in it or something, anything. I'm grateful for all of it. Like, it's been a great journey. Yeah. Hopefully.
So, when people think about your name, Yojairy, mm-hmm. or Two Guns, mm-hmm. no, I'm joking. What do you want them to think about? What do you want them to remember? Who do you want them to remember you as?
Yo, that girl is funny as fuck. Just like that. That's it. Yeah, that's all that's I want. That, yo, if they see me and be like, yo, you're funny as fuck, I swear to God, that'll make my day. I'll be like, yes. Yes, that's right. I'm just here to make you laugh, man.
Appreciate that.
Thank you so much, Bastien, for having me on the show. I really appreciate it, not for real. It was a great conversation. Thank you guys for everything, setting up the lighting. It was great. I appreciate the quick responses too. I'm like, yo, they're quick with it. All right, let's get to work, boys. But this has been great. Thank you so much for everything, and I hope, you know, you keep doing great with your mm-hmm. with your show, mm-hmm. with your YouTube page. It's only up from here. And if you ever want to have a conversation again, maybe a year from now, see where I am, we could make that work.
We're gonna be in a different studio,
of
right?
course. Like, bigger studio, bigger studio. Lights, more cameras, all of that.
Mm-hmm. Whole production team.
Yes, sir.